good father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am.
Amen. Amen. It's already been a full morning. But we're not quite done yet, because we are our Unity Bible Church, so we will take some time in God's Word today. We have been doing this series called Kingdom Living out of the Sermon on the Mount given by the Lord Jesus Christ. It's found in Matthew's chapters 5, 6, and 7. And we are actually in the home stretch of finishing this sermon, this message given by the greatest person who's ever lived, Jesus himself. So we've been doing this since January 1, and so we are very much in the very last section. There's today's message and two more, and then we will have finished this remarkable message by Jesus Christ. I know we have some guests with us. If you're curious or interested about all that is up there and what all that might mean, you can go onto YouTube and type in Unity Bible Church, Lewiston, Maine, and it will bring up our YouTube channel, and you will have all of that from the last number of months that we have been making our way through. So today, we're going to focus in on Matthew chapter 7, verses 15 through 20. Last week, we talked about two paths, an illustration Jesus gave us about how one would enter the kingdom of heaven. Today, we're going to look at two trees, and I'm sorry, but the topic at hand today happens to be beware of false prophets. And so, the scripture in front of us this morning is here. Allow me to read that, have a word of prayer with you, and then we will consider what Jesus Christ has for us today. The Lord continues, beware of false prophets who come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly are ravenous wolves. You will recognize them by their fruits. Are grapes gathered from thorn bushes or figs from thistles? And the answer, of course, is of course not. So every healthy tree bears good fruit, but the diseased tree bears bad fruit. A healthy tree cannot bear bad fruit, nor can a diseased tree bear good fruit. Every tree that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. It's an expression of judgment. He finishes in verse 20, thus you will recognize them, these false prophets, by their fruits. Let's pray. Let's pray. Let's bow our heads in the presence of the Lord God. Father, this morning we wish to thank you for the opportunity we've had to sing praises to your name, the opportunity to approach your throne of grace and mercy as Pastor Dan brought us before you to pray over our many needs. Thank you, Father, that Dan has lifted up the word to you. And we ask, Father, that you would be pleased to use your word in our hearts even today. Draw us in, help us to understand, I pray. And Father, we pray these things for your glory in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen. All right. So we're going to kind of hit this. I wasn't sure exactly how long the beginning section of the dedication would take, so we'll see how quickly we can come through this. So Jesus begins this statement about false prophets with this expression. He says, beware of false prophets. You can extend that. Beware of false prophets, beware of false teachers, beware of false preachers, beware of false pastors, notice, who come to you in sheep's clothing. Now, what he's saying is this, beware of those who come to you in a religious capacity. You know, they may look good, they may sound good, they even may smell good. They may carry a big Bible, but they are pretending. They are pretending to be something. Because, notice, they come to you in sheep's clothing. How do you get sheep's clothing? No, it's worse than shearing it. The only way to ultimately come to you in sheep's clothing is to have a sheep's skin. And the only way to have a sheep's skin is to kill the sheep in order to wear it. So they're pretending to be sheep. They pretend to care about the sheep. All the while, they are literally killing the sheep for their own benefit. So this opening statement's a little disturbing, don't you think? The idea that these people parade and masquerade is something they aren't in order to do you ill. So Jesus is warning us that these are not people that we should look up to or look fondly upon. Why? Because they're not sheep. But inwardly, they are ravenous wolves. They're hungry. They're starving wolves. They're not herbivores. They're carnivores. And their desire is not to feed the sheep, but to feed on the sheep. These false prophets do not have God's Spirit dwelling within them. Rather, they are empowered and enlightened and animated by another spirit. Notice what Paul says in 2 Corinthians 11, verses 13 to 15. Now, Paul is about to talk about false teachers, false prophets, and false apostles who were coming into Corinth. He said this, "They are false apostles, deceitful workmen, disguising themselves as apostles of Christ. And no wonder, for even Satan disguises himself as an angel of light." And so it's no surprise that his servants also disguise themselves as servants of righteousness. And their end will correspond with their deeds. And so Jesus says, beware. Paul says, beware. You know what? They're not the only ones who warn us about these false teachers, these ravenous wolves who pretend to be part of God's people. In fact, you'll discover that Ezekiel, huge sections of the book of Ezekiel are committed to this idea of false prophets. Again, Jesus here, the Apostle Paul in 2 Corinthians chapter 11, which I just read, but also the entire book of Galatians was written to the issue that there are people who are coming and preaching to you a false gospel. And Paul said, let them be accursed. The word is literally, let them be damned. The whole book of Galatians was dedicated to this idea of false teachers. Peter, in 2 Peter chapter 2, the whole thing there deals with false teachers. Jude, the little book of Jude, he wanted to write a wonderful testimony about the faith that we enjoy in Christ, but he says something more needful has come about. I need to warn you about false prophets who are already amongst God's people. So there is a huge onus in the scriptures on being careful, being aware that there are people in the midst who do not have God's Spirit and not God's intentions. They have their own intentions in mind. And you know what makes this so heinous to me? What makes this so heinous is they use God. They use God. That's such a dangerous thing to do. They use Him. They use His name. They use His resources. They use His people to make themselves a name, to line their bank accounts, and to have their followers. Now, before we push down into this and consider what to do about this, I feel as though I need to make a statement or two here just to kind of be clear about this. Some false teachers know full well they are working for Satan. They have long since sold their soul to the devil, and he can have them beyond this life, but in this life, they have sold it to be wealthy and powerful and to have enormous followings. So there are some of these who are shepherds, pastors, teachers, who have sold their soul to the devil, and they know full well what they're doing. But I also think that there are others. They don't really know that they're teaching falsehood, but they've been recruited unknowingly because Satan has taken advantage of their fallen nature, promising them money, purpose, a following, a name, a claim, And they are eager and yet unknowing agents of the devil for his purposes. So I think there are those who know. I think there are those who are unknowing. And I actually also think that there are some who are just believers, true believers, and they're ignorant. That what they're teaching and what they're preaching is not true. So this covers a whole gambit. Jesus is warning us about false prophets who's willfully false. But I think it's careful for us to think this through a little bit. Yes, there are definitely demonically empowered people who name God and are using God's people. But I think there's also a number of unknowing people. And I think there's even some ignorant believers who are caught up in this as well. So what do we do? How pervasive is this? Wonderful man of God by the name of David Mathis made this statement, and I think it's helpful. He said, the question is not whether you will ever hear the voice of false teachers, but whether you can discern which messages are false. You see, this is happening now. It's everywhere, and it's only gotten more ubiquitous in light of YouTube, and it's just, they have platforms everywhere. And the question is not, are you hearing false teaching? The question is, do you know false teaching when you hear it? And so the Apostle John actually gives us some encouragements along this line. He says this in 1 John chapter 4 and verse 1. Beloved, he's talking to believers, beloved, do not believe every spirit, but test the spirits to see whether they are from God. For many, notice, many false prophets have gone out into the world. They're already pervasive in the first century. And so he says, we need to be careful. We need to be careful to test the prophets, to know whether or not their messages are from God. And so the word test means to evaluate, to discern, to appraise, to inspect, to examine. And there's only one way to rightly examine their message. And that is against the standard. The Word of God is God's Word, and it is the standard against which we compare all things. And so the question is, is what I'm hearing from God or not? And the only way to know is to know what God's Word says. You know, years ago it used to be said that those people who worked for the Treasury Department, their job was to find counterfeit money. And so in order to know counterfeit money, they didn't study counterfeits. They studied the real thing. And they knew what a dollar looked like, what it smelled like, what it felt like, everything about it. They knew it so clearly that when something came up against it, they knew immediately this isn't right because they knew the true so well. And that's what we need to be like when it comes to this world we live in. We need to know what is true so well that when we hear something other, we're like, red flag, that's not right, that doesn't sound right, something's wrong there. I think that's one of the roles of the Holy Spirit in the lives of a believer. His goal is to say, something doesn't quite set right. Why? And then gives us that desire to investigate it a little bit further, to compare it against what God's teaching is. And so Jesus says clearly, beware of false teachers. They are already in the world and actively teaching against God's truth. So with that in mind, what do we compare this against? I believe that what Jesus has just spoken, and we looked at this last week, in Matthew chapter 7, verses 13 and 14, Jesus has made clear how one enters God's kingdom. Right after his statement there, he says, and by the way, beware of false teachers, false prophets. So Jesus is comparing what he has just spoken to what he is now saying here. And so what Jesus has just spoken, we're to test their message against these words. Jesus says, enter by the narrow gate. For the gate is wide, and the way is easy that leads to destruction. And those who enter by it are how many? Many. For the gate is narrow, and the way is hard that leads to life. And those who find it are how many? Few. So Jesus has just given us this statement, and then he says, oh, by the way, beware. because people are going to come along and they're going to contradict what I have just said. Now, some of these are easy to pick off. Some of these are false teachers are so radical in their departures from the obvious teaching of Scripture that we can just say, oh, no way. Mormons, they believe in a pantheon of gods. You can be a god as God is. As you are God once was, and as God is, you will be. We can all be God. Okay, that's wrong. And all God's people said, that's easy. Yeah, okay, we got that one. And then, of course, Jehovah's Witnesses. They say there's only one God. His name is the Father, and Jesus is a lesser God. Wait a minute. So there's multiple gods in the Godhead? Jesus is God. He is the God, Yahweh. And so we need to understand that there are those who come along and they will tell us these things, whether they be Mormons or JWs or Scientologists. They are so far outside of what's called orthodoxy, which is straight truth, that we refer to them as cults. They're so far out. And as destructive as their teaching is, and as many as they lead astray, perhaps more subtle and deadly still are those false prophets who have so much of the message and yet don't give you the whole message. Wonderful man of God whose commentary on this Sermon on the Mount that I have used in preparation each week, his name is Donald Carson, D.A. Carson. He makes this comment. It is even possible in some instances, that everything these false prophets say is true, but because they leave out the difficult bits, they do not tell the whole truth, and their total message is false. There is nothing in their teaching that fosters a poverty of spirit. Nothing that searches the conscience and makes men and women cry out to God for mercy. Nothing which excoriates all forms of religious hypocrisy. Nothing which prompts a righteousness of conduct and attitude that makes some persecution inevitable. And so what D.A. Carson is saying here is this: in preaching a partial message, they preach a false message. This is much more subtle. You need to know the truth well enough to know there's a red flag in there somewhere. You should dig around and look for it, because what they're saying isn't lining up with the truth of Christ. Now, I just want to say that we are not to be heresy hunters, but we are to be discerning and watchful and aware. The best way to be aware is to know the truth so well that all the other ways are obviously wrong in comparison. So here's the truth from Jesus' statement. We went over this last week in depth. I can't do that here. If you would like to know more about what I'm about to show you, I want to encourage you to go back to last week and to listen to, watch the message. This is Jesus' statement where he makes it abundantly clear. Enter by the narrow gate. It's a command. For the gate is wide and the way is easy that leads to destruction, and those who enter by it are many. For the gate is narrow and the way is hard that leads to life, and those who find it are few. Let me just briefly explain to you the gospel according to Jesus. You and I have been born into this world. The great gate is birth, and it's to the way of destruction. That's how we were born, dead in relationship to God and going along our merry way. It is called easy because it seems so right. It feels so good, and everyone is doing it. The key is the call of the gospel to repent. Repent. Turn from your sin. Turn from your self-righteousness. Turn from your way, your truth, your life, and come to Jesus Christ. That's the narrow gate. It's Christ himself. It is the work of the cross. Turn from the world, the flesh, the devil. Turn to Jesus Christ. The second person of the Trinity entered humanity through the womb of the Virgin Mary. He lived an absolutely perfect life where we have failed. And then he went on to die the death we deserve to die under the wrath and judgment of God. He was buried. He rose again the third day. Come to the cross. Come to Christ. Turn from your way in the world. Turn from your truth that justifies everything you've been doing. And give him your life. And once you step through that gate, the gate of the cross, you have been born again. You have been given new life, a new heart, a new spirit. You're now indwelt. You now start to walk the narrow, hard path, a life of denial, a life of determination, a life of devotion, a life of dependence, and God brings you home. Philippians 1, verse 6. Says that he who has begun a good work in you will perform it until the day of Christ Jesus. God the Father takes personal responsibility for the preservation of his children, and he will bring them all home. And all God's people said, this is the gospel. Now, we're going to give you the modern gospel. I'm going to reveal to you where so many get so far off course. False teachers subtly come in, some knowingly, others ignorantly, merely following what they have been taught, not knowing the scriptures. The first thing they want to do is they want to get rid of this whole idea of the world, the flesh, the devil. We're dead in our trespasses and our sins, that we are at odds with God, and that there's nothing we can do to change that. What are you even saying? My heart is good. This is what we're taught. You're a good person. What are you even thinking like this for? Come on. So one of the first things that a lot of false teachers do is they get rid of the message, the part of the message that deals with depravity and destruction. Ooh, we don't like that. You can't have a happy message with that. So what they do is they push sin and judgment and hell out of the picture. By the way, I didn't bring it with me, but there's a wonderful book. I have the title here. It's called Revival and Revivalism. This started to happen in America in the 1700s under John Finney and his revivalistic movement. No, we can get people to make movements if we just get them whipped up and emotional, and those movements count. Well, wait a minute. No, that's not how that even works. So this is an old way of putting aside the truth of our true nature and saying, you're good. Come on. You're good. In fact, you're so good. Let's get rid of this word repent. Ew, repent. Really? In fact, let's replace it. Let's get rid of repent. Get out of here. Go, goodbye. Let's call it believe. You know, you don't got to repent. Of what? You're a good person. All you need to do is just believe. Believe what? Believe Jesus. Oh, really? All you have to do is believe. Interestingly, James in James chapter 2 and verse 19 said, be careful. You believe that God is one. Well and good. Even the demons believe that and they tremble with fear. So simple belief, naked belief in Jesus is insufficient to save anyone's soul. Because when you get into John's gospel, what you begin to understand is in John 1:12, we're told that not only are you to believe, but you are to receive the Lord Jesus Christ into your life. In addition to that, in John chapter 3 and verse 36, it parallels believe with obey. So you're receiving the person of Christ into your heart, into your life. You're now called to obey him by following him. And by the time you get to the end of the Gospel of John, chapter 20 and verse 28, you discover that you're now to worship this God with your life. Words, in bare definition, don't have real meaning. Meaning is found in context. You take the word believe and follow it through the Gospel of John, and you realize it means to receive, obey, and to worship him as Lord and God. That's John. But ooh, that seems so harsh. We'll just tell you to believe. Why believe? I believe. Believe what? Well, that doesn't really matter. I believe. And this whole idea of Jesus being the Lord and coming under his lordship, the confession of faith in Romans chapter 10, verses 9 through 13. I tell you what, we really can't have Jesus being our master and us being his doulos, his servant, i.e. in context, slave. Oh, that's such an unpopular message. Don't you know our background as a nation? Yeah. So let's change Jesus is my Lord and I follow him with my life to the statement that Jesus is Lord. He's Lord. It's a title, right? Jesus is Lord. And all God's people said, it's true. But is he your Lord? Are you following him with your life? So we've got a happy message. We've kind of done away with sin and judgment and all that stuff. We're now encouraging people to believe. It's a smiley message. It's a happy message. Jesus is Lord. And what is this denial? Determination. Devotion. Dependence stuff. You'll never get a lot of people to move towards Christ and go to heaven with a message like that. We've got to kind of get rid of that. We've got to scour it out. And we'll replace it with my best life now. When we get through this, you're going to see the message that you'll hear taught from almost every church. And you know, it's called a hard way. Why do we call it a hard way? Wouldn't it be much better to call it a comfortable way? And you know, it's narrow. You're never going to get a lot of people down this path if it's narrow. So what we need to do is we need to promise people an easier way. An easier way to get to heaven. So let's remove the narrow road and let me give you a very popular way. It's an escalator. That's right. You see, this is the believe in Jesus, hallelujah, get baptized, my best life now, automatic escalator to ecstasy and glory, hallelujah. And all God's people said, whoa, red flags, red flags. Now this pushes down on something I'll take only a moment with, because I only have a moment. But this comes back to something that most of us have heard from reputable people, but we should think carefully about. And it's the statement, once saved, always saved. Think this through. Think this through. That statement, once saved, always saved, means that if you get one toenail onto this modern automated gospel, one toenail, before you know it, you're in glory. It doesn't really matter how you live your life or what you do, because you're on the escalator, because it's only going up. It's automatic. You get on it, you step on it, and next thing you know, you're in glory. Whoa, what a deal. And yet Jesus said it's a hard way, with trials and testing and pain and suffering. You see, time and testing prove the reality of all things. And so God puts us, after our confession, through time and testing. And Peter says, you should consider it all gold and glory when God tests your faith. And it comes out as, I still love God. Because many walk away. Many walk away. So many of today's messages around salvation require no sanctification, no pain, no suffering, no holiness, just guaranteed glory. was at the shelter a few months back now, Eric. And let's see, you weren't there, Michael, for some reason, and Marcel wasn't there to play music for some reason, and we had a lovely young man there with a guitar. And the speaker that night didn't show up. And I'm sitting there, I probably should have gotten up and said something, but I didn't. And the guy did a fabulous job, fabulous job. He played some songs and he gave his testimony. Beautiful testimony, beautiful testimony. I said, amen. And then he realized I had more time. He kept playing his guitar and singing some songs. And then he gave an exhortation. He had read something in the Word and it had touched his heart and it shaped him to want to please God with his life. And he gave that exhortation. I said, amen, amen, well said, well spoken. And then he stepped to a place he shouldn't have gone. He took the Bible, opened it up, and said, turn to this portion of Scripture. And that night, he tried to teach everyone in the shelter, once saved, always saved. And he gave an illustration. God loved that man. He gave an illustration. There was a guy who grew up in his church. He was young, made a profession of faith, was baptized young. And he found him in the community one day while he was in a store, and he bumped into him, and he said, hey, how are you? Haven't seen you in church in a long time. And the guy said, yeah, I don't do that anymore. I have no interest in going there. He said, no, no, really, you should come back to church. You know, we would love to see you. Everybody remembers you. Oh, we'd love to have you. Yeah, I'm not going there. I don't do that anymore. And then he made this statement. He said, you're going to be terribly shocked one day when Jesus Christ comes and drags you kicking and screaming into heaven because he believed once saved, always saved. It doesn't matter if you walk away and willfully give up on Christ. Can I say, he may be surprised when he wakes up one day in hell because he believed the lie. Once saved, always saved. And it doesn't matter how you live. Very popular teaching. Let me be clear. Once truly converted by God's grace, once truly born again and indwelt by the Holy Spirit, you will, by God's grace, persevere in obedience in the narrow way of God's word, and you will end up in God's presence. That's the teaching of Scripture. Again, Philippians 1:6. He who has begun a good work in you will perform it until the day of Christ Jesus. That's a wonderful statement of assurance of God's preservation over those who truly belong to him. But in Philippians 2, verses 12 and 13, it says this. Work out your salvation with fear and trembling, for it's God who works in you both to will and to do of his good pleasure. So God's preservation comes together with our perseverance, and we make it home all by the grace of God. And all God's people said, amen. That's the gospel. It's an escalator, and you got your toenail on it, and look where you found yourself. No, that's not biblical. That's not biblical. So again, that dear young man, amen. You should have a personal story of testimony that you can give at any time of what God has done in your life. Yes. You should have an exhortation that God has put in your heart from reading his word that morning. You can say, you know, God spoke to my heart this way and I've changed my life in light of that. Amen. But be careful not to be a teacher of God's word. Listen. Listen. James says this, not many of you should become teachers, my brothers, for you know that those who teach will be judged with a greater strictness. So give a testimony, give an exhortation, but be careful not to take the position of a teacher and say, thus says the Lord. That's a humbling position to take. So one should study to show himself approved under God, a workman that does not need to be ashamed, one who can rightly divide the word of truth. That's that. All right, moving right along. We got to get rid of the cross. We just got to get rid of the cross. It's an offense. The cross is an offense. In fact, even Paul said the cross is an offense. He said in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 22 and 23, the Jews demand signs and the Greeks seek wisdom, but we preach Christ crucified. He's a stumbling block. That means people can't get over it. To the Jews, and it's folly to the Gentiles. So the cross has got to go. It's not inclusive enough. We've got to open the path big and wide so that we can get as many as we can up this path. And it's offensive. So what do we replace the cross with? How about good works? There we go. Good works. Let's pull it together, shall we? The modern gospel. The modern gospel is that the broad gate opens up to the easy, comfortable way where I believe and I will live my best life now and I will do good works all along the way and I'll be in heaven when I die. This message is everywhere. It's everywhere. A man by the name of Richard Niebuhr, in a book called The Kingdom of God in America, said this about the American gospel. This was written back in the 50s. He said, "They preach a God without wrath, who brings men without sin into a kingdom without judgment through a Christ without a cross." And it is a lie. Now let's finish this, because here's the goal of false teachers. This is the reason why they make their message this way. And I'd like you to look up there. I want you to see why they teach this way. Now watch. Are you watching? Okay, in case you missed it, let me do that again. Okay, and so this is their goal. Their goal is to have it be so broad, so easy, so comfortable, so wonderful, that the many make it into God's presence. Love wins, hallelujah! And only a few people go to hell. Only a few, you know, Hitler. Hitler's in hell, and all God's people said, yeah, we know that. But you can no longer say, like, Chairman Mao is in hell. You can no longer say that Stalin is in hell. Now, they murdered tens of millions of their own people, but they were communists, and they just didn't know how to do it right. And so today's Marxist communists, we can do a better job, trust us. And you all said, no way. So the only people that we know are going to be in hell based upon the modern gospel is Hitler and probably Trump and his followers. That's just kind of how that all seems to work. I got one little political statement in there. Okay, we'll move on. We'll move on. Thank you. Amen. But listen. They are teaching that most people are going to heaven. Because all people are basically good people who do good things, and God is a good God. So heaven will be full. But hear me, please hear me. False teachers are not concerned about heaven. They are concerned with filling their churches with people who think they're going to heaven. That's their goal. They want the many people to come through their doors, to be entertained by their worship, to put their money into their ministries, to line their pockets for these for-profit prophets. They're building their own empires. And so they alter the message of Christ to make it as easy as possible for as many as possible, and deceiving many. The next statement from Jesus Christ after this statement is this: not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but the one who does the will of my Father, which is revealed in the word. On that day, many will say to me, Lord, Did we not prophesy in your name? Did we not cast out demons in your name? And do many mighty works in your name? And I will declare to them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you workers of lawlessness. Jesus made it very plain. That few there be who repent in this life, come to Jesus Christ in faith and give him their lives, and then begin to walk the road of sanctification through denial and determination and devotion and dependence. It is our need to persevere as God preserves, and we go home. Dear ones, this is the gospel. It's a hard truth. It's not an easy truth, but making it easier doesn't make it right. There's only one truth. Christ has clearly expressed it. Clearly expressed it. What time is it? Oh, Bill, you get another hour. Okay. I'm just looking at your faces. That's okay. No, we won't do it there. So, indeed, we need to test their message. We need to test it against the Word of God. We need to test it against the teachings of Scripture. We need to understand that there are many false prophets who are already in the world, pretending to be sheep, but they're ravenous wolves. And I would have us test their ministry and consider their fruits. Because again, time and testing reveals the truth about all things. We're not going to do that right now. Next week, when we come back, we're going to talk about the warning of false assurance. False assurance. Your assurance that you're going to heaven one day has nothing to do with a past act. It has to do with a present reality in your life. We're going to talk about that. Next week, we're going to talk about biblical evidences for true new birth. So I will invite you back to that. I feel like we've gone down this path far enough. But I just want to say, I don't know what the Holy Spirit is doing in your hearts and lives right now. But he will draw you to his Son. And you will see him for who he is, the Lord God Almighty. And you will fall at his feet with your life. And you will say, if you will have me, I will trust you with this whole life, and I will follow you. And he will wrap his arms around you, put his Holy Spirit within you, stand you on your feet, and walk with you through the remainder of this life until you come home to be with the Father. Dear Father, thank you for the words of the Lord Jesus Christ. Thank you that not only does he make clear the truth about a narrow door that leads to a narrow way that is hard, where few seem to find it, but he also warns us that there are many who will take his message and alter it for their own designs. I just pray that you give us ears to hear, eyes to see the truth, and I pray that we would desire to know you and the truth. Father God, again, use these few words this morning for your glory. Continue to draw each heart closer to Christ. Some don't know him yet. May that day be soon. Others of us know him. Help us to really love him and to know his word and to follow him closely, I pray. Father, I pray these things for your glory in Jesus' name. And all God's people said,